It's an important story on the front page of The Sun, actually. Anybody watching their petrol prices this summer? Oil rigged is the headline on The Sun. Motorists fleeced of £200 each. Fat cats fail to pass on savings. This is because some MPs are calling for there to be a particular watchdog of petrol prices. Campaigners say that actually there was a period last year where diesel wholesale costs fell by 9%, but at the pumps, they reckon that only we saw a 0.5% drop in diesel prices. So some saying we should watch that. The petrol industry say it's just reflective of global oil prices and it's fair. Keep an eye on the pumps at the minute, though. Oil prices ticking up a little bit. You might have noticed your tank getting a bit more expensive in the last few weeks.
I have.
You have, yes. Exactly. Making clothes cheaply and quickly, but Sean's here to tell us about a bit of pressure from consumers about, I suppose, ethical concerns. Is that right?
Yeah, and there's a lot of money involved, so big issue for the companies. Morning, everybody. Getting clothes from the catwalk to the shop floor is big business. There's a bit of a league table put together by the campaigning organisation Fashion Revolution that keeps tabs on how the big names are doing when it comes to things like impact on the environment, work conditions involved in making plain white T-shirts like these and lots more clothes on the shop floors. Now, out of 200 brands, 38 are now disclosing details of their processing facilities. So that's in the factories where things like the spinning, the dyeing, the laundering is all taking place. Just over half of the brands say what their carbon footprint right around the world is now. So that's improving a little bit. Only six brands, though, out of the 200 published detail of the labour costs of their suppliers, which, of course, will have a big impact on what workers are being paid. Now, we went out and asked a few shoppers whether they know or even care how their clothes are made.
I do a little bit think about it, but it doesn't affect if I want something.
I'm a student, so I just need cheap clothes, really.
That's exactly what we've been doing today, student shopping.
Value for money, really.
I think more who makes it, like the designer. I think that's what I look for.
I kind of try not to think of it too much, because then you'd be constantly worried, were you buying things, all that sort of stuff. So you just sort of hope that the big corporations, as they're probably not doing, are like paying the wages and stuff like that.
Interesting. Well, let us know your thoughts. We've got Carrie Summers with us, who's the founder of Fashion Revolution, that charity I mentioned. Morning to you, Carrie.
Good morning.
Do people care? Wasn't the most optimistic outlook from a lot of people there about how much they worry about what goes into these clothes?
Well, people have to care. I mean, we just simply cannot afford to carry on living in a world where our clothes are contributing so much to climate change, to human rights abuses, and the reinforcing gender inequality. We really have to see a radical transformation in the fashion industry. We have to start caring.
There's a difference, though, isn't there, between what you might think we have to do and whether customers are still happy to pay £2 for a plain white T-shirt and they don't know how that's being made. Like, do you see, you've done this index for a few years now, are you actually seeing customer habits change?
We're certainly seeing customer habits change and we're seeing brand habits change as well. We know that the index is pushing brands to be more transparent, and once they're more transparent, they're more accountable, and eventually that will lead to a change in the way in which the industry works. So we need change from brands and from consumers. We can't continue to consume in this completely unsustainable way, and also ultimately we need legislation as well to get those laggard brands to move.
Well, that's interesting, because there's a difference, isn't there, between transparency, which this index is about how open businesses are about how they make their stuff, and actually how sustainable it is. Now, just because you come top of a transparency list, it doesn't mean customers can automatically think that the brands that come top of this list are the most sustainable out there, does it?
No, it doesn't mean they're the most sustainable. I mean, it does tend to mean that they are the brands who are doing more, because if they're transparent, they're happy to disclose that information. And it's good for the brand's reputation. If they're disclosing their factory lists and information about their supply chain, it means if there are human rights abuses happening, they're able to identify those and deal with them more quickly. So that does ultimately help to protect the brand's reputation.
When we've talked about fast fashion in the past, we talk a lot about individuals' waste. Maybe you're just wearing this T-shirt or dress a couple of times and then maybe chucking it. But what about the waste by the industry before it even gets to the shops? I mean, are there loads of these T-shirts being chucked away into landfill that aren't sold?
Yes, there are. And really, we have no idea how much that is. That's why we're asking one of our questions in the index about what are you doing with your unsold clothes and defective stock. And considering the stock burning scandals with Burberry and H&M last year, very few brands are actually disclosing any information about this. I mean, estimates are that about 15% of textiles end up on the cutting room floor. But where does all of this fabric go? Where does the clothing go? We really don't know.
So that's an area you'd like to see more transparency.
Definitely.
Kerry, thank you very much. Kerry Summers there from Fashion Revolution. We've got Primark, Boohoo updating us this morning, two huge retailers. And it'd be very interesting to see if any of this plays out in their results at all. Profits,
Amit, well, indeed. Yeah, so many questions we don't know the answer to as yet. Thank you.
There. 10 to 8. Good morning to you. Sean is talking fast fashion this morning. What have you got for Sean?
Plenty for you on morning, everybody, by the way. We're talking Primark, Boohoo, two of the biggest names for people who like to do a bit of clothes shopping, specialise in fast fashion, white T-shirts like these, selling clothes cheaply, turning around new ranges, although they do have the solid ones that they sell year after year. Whether on the high street or online, though, we clearly love to buy clothes. That's the message from this morning, because Primark has reported its UK like-for-like sales went up by 0.6%. That's when you look at stores that were open the year before, but they've expanded their stores as well. They have that huge one in Birmingham. And online, Boohoo, which owns Pretty Little Thing, Nasty Gal, has seen a big increase in revenues, basically sales. So they're up 37% and profits up a lot as well. So what happens next in the shopping battle? Let's have a chat with Jen Nixon, who's a retail consultant at Gate One. Morning to you, Jen. What do you take from that? Primark doing great, Boohoo, sales up even more. What's the conclusion?
Well, I think they're both doing absolutely fantastically. So they both just really know their customer. And so they just understand exactly what they want. And they know they target them. They don't appeal to everybody. And they just know that they can get those sales through.
And so you say they know their customer. Yes. When we look at somebody like Debenhams, who's had so many problems this year or last year or two, what can they learn from what Primark are doing on the high street and maybe from what Boohoo are doing online?
So I think Boohoo, they've got their target audience, you know, 16 to 30. They know they can focus on those kind of girls shoppers. And then with Primark as well, they know that they're not going to appeal to everyone. They're not everybody's cup of tea. Whereas Debenhams, you know, they are trying to appeal to mass markets. And I think it's just too broad.
That makes it a bit tougher for them. We've been talking this morning, well, we've heard loads the last few weeks, haven't we, about the environment, sustainability. Mm. Is it possible to shop at Primark and Boohoo and feel like you're a sustainable shopper?
I think so, yeah. So I think there's always going to be a demographic where they want affordable fashion, but I think people are, they're more conscious now about the environment, and they can see that places like Primark, they really are taking steps towards that. So, you know, they're having full ranges now that are made out of sustainable cotton. You can see their partners, they're a lot more ethical in their supply chain. So people are becoming more conscious, and Primark are definitely making steps to better that.
But even if your sustainable cotton T-shirt is is more sustainable than what was being made before, isn't it just better for the environment? Doesn't the fashion industry need to realise it's better for the environment if we just don't buy as many clothes as we're buying at the minute?
I think so, but, you know, they're cheap prices, and they people are always going to want that, so there's always going to be somebody that's going to have to appeal to that market. And there are other things that they can do, so, you know, you can take back used clothes and have processes to deal with that. You can look at your returns policy, like ASOS did, to try and combat that in different ways.
That's interesting. So are we starting to see now retailers make bigger moves? H&M had an announcement yesterday, didn't they, about giving more details on where their products are specifically coming from.
Yeah, definitely.
Is that what customers want?
I think so, yeah. H&M have done a great thing where you can kind of click on a product online and you see exactly where it was made and exactly what materials are in it. So I think people are starting to move towards that, and I think you'll see other retailers kind of following suit.
Jen, thank you very much.
Great.
Jen Nixon there from Gate One, retail consultant. So, whatever, we're just buying loads of clothes. That's the upshot of Primark and Boohoo results this morning.
OK, Sean, thank you very much.
If you're waking up this morning and thinking about a new job, well, how about Governor of the Bank of England? It's up for grabs, Sean, isn't it?
It is. The advert is up online.
What are the qualifications you need?
Quite niche,
right?
To put it mildly, yeah. So if you have
Have bank accounts.
Yes, that's a good start.
Okay.
You'd need to be able to successfully lead, influence, and manage a complex and powerful financial institution.
Right.
In many households, you might feel like managing budgets is a similar kind of thing, but I mean, clearly, very serious job. So the beginning of next year in 2020, have a look at the.
I'm having a look
what's
at the
needed. Update your CV, Lou. 2020 in January next year, Mark Carney, the current governor of the Bank of England, is going to be departing. So they're starting now. They probably have already had some conversations behind the scenes in the Treasury about the kind of person they would like. But they're now the advert is out there. They're ramping it up. They're inviting applications. It's a big role because, amongst many other things to do with financial stability in the UK, big decisions. Mark Carney, the governor of the Bank of England, would lead the committee that makes the decisions on where interest rates go, for example. And so they're huge decisions that have big impacts on people's personal lives. But when the job advert goes out there, it does make you start thinking, you know, you don't need, it doesn't say anywhere that you need Microsoft Office skills, for example. You may not, but it's not on the official job description from the Treasury.
He's been in post for a long time, hasn't he, Mark Carney?
He has. I mean, it's an 8-year term is what this would be, £480,000 a year. That's not changed since 2013. So if you're thinking of applying for it, thinking, hang on, it's not gone up in the last 6 years. 480 grand's not enough. Might not be for you.
It's a lot of money, isn't it?
It's a lot of money. It's a big job with a big team.
The ability to use sound judgments to make decisions in a timely manner against a background of uncertainty.
And there are 400,000 gold bars worth more than £100 billion. Here's a few of them. I don't know how we got in.
But, yeah. Security was extremely tight. Yep.
I'm sure it was. But no gold bar has ever been stolen in 320 years of the Bank of England's history.
Wow. Well, that's fact of the day, that, Sean.
So if you, it's better than your insect one, isn't
it?
Yeah. If you, so if you're the governor of the Bank of England, you don't want to be the first one to have.
What do they do with
lost a gold bar?
Ignorant question. What goes on with all that stuff?
The gold bars.
Yeah.
Great door stops. It's a big building.
You could do all sorts of that, couldn't you?
You need, it's the foundations of the financial system, isn't it? If you want to get into it.
Without the girl bars, we're in trouble. Yeah.